earlier question period. So I guess I say good morning, everybody. I say good evening or good night to a few that I see present. And welcome to our last SoCal Plasma Zoom seminar for 2020, and we will be continuing in 2021. Quite a few interesting talks booked. And today we're pleased to have our speaker direct from France, Guillaume de Pradelier. And Guillaume has a history with SoCal. He did his PhD with CEA on concerned with rotation in gyrokinetics. And he for his work, he won the EPS Thesis Excellence Award. He did a postdoc at UC San Diego and had a very productive time here and went out in a blaze of glory, for those of us who remember. And he then returned to CEA, where he's been ever since. And he's made major contributions in a variety of things, in ranging from ELMs to staircases and boundary interactions. And when he's not solving the problems of magnetic confinement physics, you can find him either playing rugby or discussing French politics. I don't know which is a more vicious pursuit, but he pursues both. And today, speaking of kind of rough and tumble pursuits and one which arouses ideology, he's going to tell us about plasma boundary interplay. So.
Thank you very much for these nice words. I wish I could play rugby some more, but these days I'm getting old. But at least the French team is again performing correctly, so I'm happy. That's not the same with politics. Okay, so it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for having me. As Pat mentioned, I'll be talking about plasma boundary interplay and giving you a few ideas that I've been working on for quite some time now on what happens when you try to improve boundary conditions and when you relax steel separations. And this has direct incidence on transport barrier formation and on turbulence organization in the edge. So this is the old story, although the tail may be wagging the dog, because a very narrow region at the edge actually controls quite a bit of the dynamics of the value I'm going to show you. So, the major motivation, I think I'll zoom through this because all of you know this fairly well. it's fairly very important to describe and understand whereby bifurcations might occur. Those transitions, they come in many flavors, but they all have common grounds. The onset of a differential rotation, the steepening of the pressure gradient, and the onset of an electric field well or a hill, and as described by early works by Pat and a lot of works since then, it all enters the shear-induced bifurcation paradigm. And this is extremely robustly observed in a variety of machines. Basically, any relevant machine has shown this kind of phenomena. But on the other hand, almost all of the, I would say, the kind of first principles between quotes, modeling attempts have failed at reproducing, or at least have not succeeded in having self-consistent transitions, or at least illustrating the fundamental mechanisms that will lead to such transitions. But it's widely believed that, especially in the plasma edge, a narrow region interacting with the boundary might be absolutely key to understand this fault. So the global impact that a very localized interaction may have, it's a classical problem in fluids that dates back to quite a bit. There has been recently some interesting things in swirling flows and Van Karman flows, showing that if you would control through torque or through velocity, meaning forcing is important, you would end up in very different steady states. The MFE equivalent would be how much upstream core and edge plasma would be impacted by the way you connect magnetically to the material boundaries. So in this work, what I'm going to try to discuss now is the interplay that one gets between core, edge, and soil. What are the mechanisms through which this might occur? And how does the propagation of information take place? And does it take place? And spoiler, we do find that there is a strong interplay. So our goal is more modest at first. It's definitely not addressing the LH transition or whatever. It's to understand the L mode edge and how the turbulence organizes there, because that's a key thing, because that's where bifurcation to H mode occurs. So there is a large body of theoretical works and concepts proposed. And I would say that's a personal statement, but I think that it's very true. The added value from first principles, if it is not to complement the understanding or to discriminate between the theoretical mechanisms, well, there's a little, it's of little interest. So that's what we're going to try to look at and to, it's going to test a few of the theoretical ideas that have been floating around, and our chairman will probably recognize quite a bit of those ideas. So this work actually connects several conundrums. The first of all is, are turbulence properties locally determined? And what I want to show you here, it's a recent paper that's currently under review. We've systematically compared Gisela, which is plot-driven. I'll further describe the terms later on, but Gisela, plot-driven gyrokinetics, systematically compared to quasi-linear qualities here in blue, and to GKW, which is a local gyrokinetic code. So at the nominal Gisela parameters, what you get is a significant flux. It turns out that this significant heat flux, for the significant heat flux, the profiles are just below what would be a nonlinear stability predicted by gradient-driven local gyrokinetics, meaning that those codes at nominal parameters, they present zero flux. And you have to increase artificially, very significantly, way outside error bars, to start getting a flux, which is not anywhere close to what we get from GDL. So in those regimes, what the take-home message from that is that in near-marginal regimes, where your profiles are at or just below nonlinear stability, well, you get very different predictions depending on how you allow your system to self-organize and how you force and how you deal with the steel interplay. So that's the first thing. The second one is there an intrinsic problem with the plasma edge? And by plasma edge, I mean that region, a normalized radius loosely defined between 0.7, 0.8, 0.9, whatever, Well, basically, if you look at here, these are D3D measurements. And here in red are the predictions from gyro in this case, but this is a very generic picture. When you go further out towards the last block surface, local goals have growing difficulties to actually get the right amount of transport. And this begs the question, where does edge turbulence come from? And how much does propagation or contamination of neighboring turbulent region contribute to the edge general activity? It has often been stated that this problem, which is often referred to as the shortfall conundrum, the shortfall problem in no man's land, is somewhat solved. And this is illustrated here. My take on that is quite different, because what you see here is in black, you would get that would be the experimental heat flux that one would expect. At nominal parameters, you're somewhere around here in blue or here in red. And tweaking the profiles by here -10%, +10, +22, -2, etc., you are able to match the fluxes. But that, from a predictive perspective, is absolutely tells you that there is a very large sensitivity to the gradients. And from an understanding perspective and from a predictive perspective, that's a catastrophe. I wouldn't say anything else than, you know, this has probably said that gyrokinetics is not invalid, but has by no means cured this shortfall problem, because you need to know the answer to know how much you have to tweak the profiles to get the correct one. And the third related problem is what presides over the onset of the edge transport barrier. So here I show a very famous graph from Human Diamond, when you have with increasing input power, the turbulence intensity, which shows basically a bifurcation from R to H with the differing phase. And the Reynolds stress is found to play a key role, and this has been discussed quite a bit. So, given all of those three problems, you may ask what would be a desirable minimal set of ingredients that you need to address this problem. So here's what I think is a minimal set that is required. Since when getting closer to the edge, the equilibrium gradient length can go down to a few normal radii, all of the scale separations that may be valid somehow, somewhat in the core, actually are probably going to break down near the edge. That means that the gradient scale that's usually associated to a large scale and to the equilibrium distribution function is not that much greater than the turbulence scale. So the separation between an equilibrium and fluctuations is probably not a good idea. The second thing is that when you get to the edge, and especially in the scrape-off layer, you have very large uncertainties in the profiles to the point that they are poorly known in the scrape-off layer. So that's well known by the community that does fluid modeling, for instance, of the scrape-off layer. They're all flux-driven, because profiles should be an end result of the input flux. But when you do that, both relaxing the scale separations and allowing for the profiles to adapt during this flux-driven framework, so you can have propagation of information on global scales, and you have additional symmetry breaking mechanisms also for the edge turbulence. A third important ingredient is probably to account somewhat for the magnetic connection to the material boundaries. And the basic reason may be that in the core, you would expect the radioelectric field to go like grad P over M. Sorry, it's not the shear, it's the radioelectric field, of course, to go like grad P over M, and then the straight up layer like minus grad T E. So you would expect a shear to rise when at the transition between closed and open field lines, and you could clearly see that this may play a role in the transport barrier concept. So we'll take all of those three ingredients, and well, since this is either early or late, let me show you a few of the results for you not to leave too early. Here is what you get when you actually, this is a systematic comparison when we've relaxed all or some of those necessary ingredients. And in red here, all of those ingredients are present. In blue, some or not. And in yellow, none or. And you see that what happens here in the edge, when looking at the normalized fluctuation in the level of turbulence, is quite dramatically changed. So this is what part of what I'm going to be discussing now. So the minimally relevant framework, I would say, to address the L mode edge, well, we do that using the GZ approach. That solves the gyrokinetic equation coupled to the quasi neutrality equation. So we evolve the profiles, meaning that we input a heat source here. So we have a flux driven evolution of the profiles. We solve the domain all the way from the core to the wall here at 1.3, whatever. But it means that we surface solve core, edge, and straight path. We have recently developed a politely localized toroidal limiter that in some region of toroidal and radial space is, through a penetration technique, is a heat and momentum sink. So it actually is going to be it's incorporated in the numerical framework through penalization, meaning that we define masks that define the precise shape of the limiter and relax the full distribution function to a target distribution function with lower density, lower temperature, etc. And at the same time, in this ripoff layer, we modify the potential response so that in this ripoff, we mimic the condition that we would get at the plasma sheath, namely phi goes like lambda T E over E. And that's the framework that we're going to use. And what I'm going to show now is a systematic comparison where we've taken shots, parameters of a top supra shot, this one, whatever. We took this one because we have good refractometry data, meaning we have good fluctuation data to which we can compare to. But the important part is that I'm going to systematically compare a framework where we are flux driven with the limiter. Flux-driven, but we have a polygonally symmetric boundary condition, which means that here, this term here, we make it vanish, and compared also to a gradient-driven framework with a polygonally symmetric boundary condition. So the polyhedrally symmetric boundary condition means that we have a poly uniformly distributed sink at the edge. So those two terms go to zero. And the gradient driven means that we do not have a source of heat, and we relax the distribution function towards a constant distribution function, which is going to be the one computed at steady state from this set of parameters here. So we run the flux driven with the polygon symmetric, wait for steady state, we take that distribution function and we impose it as the condition for the gradient driven. So these are the three cases that I'm going to systematically compare. So, the poor resolution, so here you see the three cases. So case one is going to be the case one, case two, and case three. So here we just have an illustration of whatever with the limiter, etc. But you can see straight away a few interesting facts here. With the limiter versus without, you see that you have a very narrow region here at the transition between closed and open field lines, which is going to behave very differently. And that narrow region is then going to significantly impact what happens in the outer edge. So what I'm going to discuss now in the remainder is, first of all, the polygonal asymmetry that develops when you have a limiter. Look at the linear. This is a bit tedious, but we've gone through a lot of pain to actually look at the linear stability of those equilibria. Then discuss what happens in no man's land and the spreading and contamination of turbulence. And then discuss the transport barrier onset through vorticity dynamics. So first of all, the colloidal asymmetry. So this is color-coded here in the vicinity of the limiter. It's light blue here, darker blue outside, and red everywhere else. So this is this color coding. So what you see here is that, the system is reacting as you would expect through the introduction of the cold spot here, but the limiter. The plasma, the limiter surrounds itself by an over dense region. And at the transition here between closed and open field lines, you kind of see a steep decrease of both density and temperature profiles. If you look at the normalized density gradients and temperature gradient, here in red is the average from 0.9 to 2.98. You see quite significant gradients develop. And if you were only to look at what happens from 0.9 to 0.94, basically it's kind of smooth. So it means that you have a very narrow, that's what you see here, you have a narrow region of gradients, both in density and temperature, that arises and that keeps being there throughout the duration of the simulation. Comparatively, when you do not have a limiter, and this is the cases two and three, basically this is what you get. You have very constant in polygonal angle, so a polygonally uniform distribution of gradients. Of course, I haven't said it, but all of those three cases are initialized in the same way. So there is no bias in there. So now you may ask, what kind of instability would those gradients generate? So this is without a limiter. Without a limiter, what we do is to take the profiles from this torsi pressure, we run the flux driven with the polygon symmetric, we reach steady state, we extract all of the main profiles, we reconstruct a distribution function which is going to be the target for the gradient driven, and we rerun again. And we look at the stability at different radial position, namely normalized radius of 0.92, 0.98, and 1.03. And these are those 2D plots represent the max growth rate versus normalized gradient of density and normalized gradient of temperature. These are obtained by local analysis by the GKW code, which is well suited for that. So the bottom line is that, well, we're marginally stable, but all of those graphs must be obtained at vanishing E Crosby shear and in a polyhedrally homogeneous assumption, with a polyhedrally homogeneous assumption. And that's a big assumption, because even if this is correct for the gradient driven, well, without the limiter, it becomes very very incorrect with the limiter. So it's only indicative here, the kind of instability that we actually get. But the end result is that the ITG and TDMs are relatively unstable below 0.92, and the important part is the outer edge past 0.92 is stable. And that's the important thing, because then we can see how turbulence contaminates a stable region. If we were to compare to the limited case, what you would see is that inside at 0.92, it's still marginally stable. In the strip of layer, it's still marginally stable. And when you look at 0.98, which is very close to the last growth flux surface, while the gradients that I've shown before, well, they really drive a very significant amount of instability. So the bottom line is, well, ITG, TM, whatever would be unstable. So what we do here, and also locally, PVG could be, you know, Kelvin Helmholtz could also be unstable. But the important part is the rest of the edge is stable. And so we are in a very interesting situation when we can look at how the turbulence organization in the edge occurs, because it is supposed to be stable and it is only destabilized through the interplay with the material boundaries. So in order to look at that, we investigate the relative level of fluctuations, delta n over n. And for this shot, it's partly the reason why we took it. We have good reflectometry data. This is actually here. And we mimic this synthetic diagnostic with GZR. So what I'm going to show here is a kind of a synthetic diagnostic, mimicking what the reflectometry measurement would give. So, so what we see here is that forcing and boundary conditions are key. Well, because when you have the limiter boundary condition, this is the delta n over n that you would get. So you get a very reasonable trend with the limiter. When you don't have a limiter, this is the blue pulse driven and the yellow gradient driven with no limiter, you get a shortfall. And you also see that between blue and yellow, the main difference between gradient driven and pulse driven is going to give you the amount of spreading. You see that you get a significant difference. So the spreading part of transport is also key. So before I discuss this in further detail, you can ask whether or not I'm cherry picking, you know, exactly the case that I went to display. The answer is no. So I've done extensive variation in parameters. to be sure that this is generic. So I show only part of it here. We still have, bottom line is we still have a shortfall. Should you change the Q value, the magnetic shear value, the ratio of TE over TI, the density gradient varies quite significantly. Core spreading from an unstable core spreading outside, outwards towards the edge is insufficient to recover the correct level of fluctuations in the edge. And should you constrain through a gradient drawing-like model the amount of self-organization, you get a big shortfall. That's the bottom line. So to quantify the self-advection of those turbulent patches, I'm following here what has been initiated by Mator and Pat, and there's quite a bit of literature on the topic. We follow wave energy budget with a concept quantity being the density times the turbulence intensity. The fact that you have the density here, as pointed out as early as this paper, just tells you that this is the so-called beach effect, where you have the fewer the oscillators as you go towards the edge, the larger you have to share the same oscillations well, so you get an increase in the apparent amplitude of the oscillations. But that's just a statement of conservation of the wave action here. So you get a conservation equation, which looks like this, with the key quantity here being the wave energy flux, which is going to be the kinetic proxy for spatial radial turbulence spreading. So the procedure that I'm going to follow is to look at, we have polygonal asymmetries, which are limited bound. We have those growing patches of turbulence intensity near the left cross flux surface. So we compute systematically this wave energy flux. I choose a reference time, which is a nonlinear time. What I'm going to show you is to investigate systematic spreading increments. And by spreading increments, I mean the wave energy flux at one time and on the full radial polygonal plane minus the same thing at a reference time. So a systematic change in the flux of the spread. So we get a time series of polygonal cross sections of those spreading increments. So if it's positive, it will be radially outwards, negative. It's a radially inward flux of turbulence intensity. So this is what it looks like. So let me take a little bit of time to walk you through this. It's a lot of information, but it's quite simple in the end. Those are all different times, so increasing times. This is polygonal angle versus normalized radius. So your limiter is here. What you see is here you have a minus, meaning that it's earlier than the nonlinear time I chose as a reference, and you see that the limiter bound fluctuations, well, they create something here near the last closed flux surface, which contributes outwards, inwards, etc., fluxes of turbulence intensity. And as you go along, what you see is a systematic behavior. The systematic behavior occurs within, let's say, 1 millisecond or whatever. But the important point is, arising from the tip of the limiter, we get a systematic and strong inward spreading of turbulence intensity. So starts here, continues there, propagates radially inwards and polyhedrally from the limiter all the way to the top. And once it has percolated basically everywhere in the edge, you get into kind of a cyclic behavior where you keep having this inward flux of turbulence activity from the limiter and outward bursts of turbulence activity, shown here, that with those parameters, the limiter being on the bottom of the plasma, comes from the top and goes outwards. So you get this cyclic behavior. To show you that this has meaning, this is what you would get looking at the time evolution of the density fluctuations. So you start with a shortfall, which you see here, because the edge is stable. So that there's no fluctuations. You progressively have fluctuations getting in, as you see here. And then when you end up in this cyclic phase, you see that the core washes outwards and the edge keeps pushing up. So you will get into, on average, this situation here. So this is all with the limiter. If you were to compare now without the limiter, this is what you get with the polyhedrally symmetric boundary condition, but the flux-driven case. And it's exactly compared to the gradient-driven case. And what you see here is that they really look very much alike, except for what happens here in this region. And that region with in the flux-driven case is a core to edge spreading of turbulence activity, which is allowed and which is impeded by construction in the gradient driven case. And that difference here accounts for the difference that you see in the density profiles between the blue and the yellow. So you have an overprediction of the fluctuations in the gradient driven case. And those in the flux-driven case both propagate outwards, fill in this region, and inwards also. So if you were to compare, to do the very simple arithmetic of, you know, you subtract this curve to this one, what you actually are looking at is the contribution of edge spreading. So this is what you have here in dark red. So you see that it's a very significant contribution from 0.9 to 1, basically. So the edge to core effect of spreading is clearly very important in this very outward region. And then if you are to do case 2 minus case 3, what you are looking at is the importance of core spreading. And you see that the core spreading contributes both to some degree outwards as well as inwards. So the end result is that in a gradient-driven case, you overpredict the turbulence activity here in the central region, and it impedes the redistribution of turbulence intensity everywhere. And in the limited case, the redistribution of the turbulence intensity close to the limiter here actually redistributes this free energy injection all the way into upstream into the confined core. Okay, so with all of that, what we have now is a significant and persistent gradient at the last place flux surface, which translates into a significant well of the radial electric field. When comparing to the cases without the limiter, which are those ones here and with those symbols in yellow, well, of course, one has as well the limiter case, and the other one is kind of a constant. So the introduction of this cold pot and this polygonal asymmetry is absolutely, and the resulting turbulence that it locally generates and redistributes is key to getting the transport barrier here. Now you may ask, what kind of mechanism is implied into getting this radioelectric field? So in order to look at that, we looked into the details and vorticity balance in radial and polaroidal plane to probe basically the mechanisms whereby the radial electric field might build up on the system. So starting from the gyrokinetic equation, only considering the neutral B velocity welcoming the gyro average, you get into a lot of people have derived an equation like that. You get into a vorticity, you get a vorticity equation. But if you develop everything, basically computed all of those terms, you can ask yourself which one are the key players, which one are the dominant ones, and which one are the negligible ones. So those in black that I show here are the negligible ones, and the relevant ones are those three. So what does that say? It says that the time variation of the vorticity, that's d2 over dr square over phi, so it's the er shear, basically is connected to the Reynolds force, as you would expect, but also you have a diamagnetic contribution, and you have a polygonal tilting. When we look at the relative weight of all of those, this is what comes out. So this is fairly recent, so it's not in a definitive shape. So sorry for the bit, it's a bit tedious to understand what's going on, but let me try to walk you through this. What's shown here is if you average over in the narrow region between normalized radius 0.97 and 1, basically, the light blue is in the build-up stage, and the dark blue is the early nomina. And the red here is further inside. So what you see is close to the last float surface in blue, or further inside the plasma, you get very significant differences in the behavior of the vorticity terms, except for the polygonal tilting. And in the and the close to where the action lies for the transport barrier onset, what you see is that the two dominant terms, well, this is the Reynolds force, and this is the advection by the diamagnetic currents of the vorticity. And surprisingly, this one is always the dominant contribution. Naively, one would easily think that the Reynolds force is the celebrated and robust contribution, but it always turns out that the diamagnetic contribution is non-negligible and quite important. And the signs are also such that those two are the ones contributing to the time to the acceleration, to the buildup of the electric shear. Now, this is also very preliminary, but I feel I also wanted to have the discussion here. There is a very interesting let me say that it's really a pain to analyze this data. This is three-dimensional data. I'm trying to look at what happens is quite a bit of a nightmare, but at least one correlation which seems very robust interesting is this one. Since the diamagnetic advection of vorticity seems to be a very important contributor, what I plot here is the radial vorticity in color, and I superimpose the diamagnetic radial velocity, but with a certain sign. And what you see is a certain sign of the radial vorticity always evokes the same sign of the vorticity of the vortices. And if I were to plot the reverse sign for here, the vorticity for the diamagnetic current, it would correlate to the red here, so to the opposite sign of vorticity. So it means that this term actually, for a reason that I do not explain, the diamagnetic currents are sign dependently affecting the vortices, so systematically contributing to the buildup of the radial electric field. Now, if you look at the correlation between the E cross B radial velocity and the vorticity, well, you don't find much of a correlation. In fact, what you get is in between those vortices, you get the radial channels of the E cross B flow, as you would expect, from basically being a secondary effect of the presence of the vortices. So what that would tend to say is that the first player that comes into play is the diamagnetic advection of the vortices. And once you get this going, now you you generate a E cross B flow and a Reynolds force and all of the usual mechanisms. But the basic, what could be the basic mechanism could be this this diamagnetic vortex interaction, diamagnetic current vortex interaction. So let me now come to the conclusions. I hope that I've shown you evidence for sole edge and core interplay, and that this interplay kind of enlightens the usual shortfall problems and illustrates also the onset and all the systemic mechanisms for transport barrier. So we implemented the penalized limiter, so with a very simplified straightforward player, so we definitely miss convection, neutrals, a lot of things. So this is a very basic thing to do. But still, what it does is that it provides free energy injection in a narrow region. And then we look at the redistribution of turbulence and find that this redistribution is actually key for the edge, and it impacts the core. And an open question is if it impacts the scrape of the layer also. So through that, we find a persistent transport barrier to build up. And the development of turbulence on the edge is a stage process. First, you develop radial asymmetry due to having a core region within the plasma. Then you have an edge to core contamination, and then as kind of a cyclic edge to core and core to edge kind of equilibration. Without the limiter, the edge is stable, and you would also always get a shortfall. And not accessible with the way we implemented the limiter, etc., is the question, how does that spill over in the scrape of layer? Does it still impact the beam on the scrape of layer, etc.? that we cannot access this physics, and we need to have convection also. From a modeling standpoint, I would say that you have a distant influence or not local influence mediated through the interplay with natural boundaries. So that certainly tells the inadequacy of scale separations and the fact that the boundary conditions are not in use in this matter. And the take-home message would be that the turbulence is not only locally driven by local gradients, but fluxes of turbulence activity primarily do not exclusively come from the edge of the key to what occurs in the plasma. So thank you very much for your attention.